Now, today is 19th. Now, today I want to present something very special and very peculiar, apparently at least, observation on Fourier transform. Let's see what is this. Fourier transform of signals not satisfying the condition of absolute integrability. We know that a signal can be Fourier transform only when it satisfies Dirichlet condition. Now there are three conditions appearing under the banner of Dirichlet condition, out of which our first condition is that the signal must be absolutely integrable. Okay. But there are signals that are not satisfying this criteria, this particular feature, that they are not absolutely integrable. Still, we can apply Fourier transform, okay, following some method. Why, how it's possible? Does it mean that the theory of Dirichlet condition is incomplete, or the theory of Fourier transform is incomplete, or there is something wrong there? No, not at all. Okay, let's see how we manage the problem for those signals that are not satisfying the condition of absolute integrability. Okay, now what are these signals? So these signals are maybe step, okay, integration of steps, signum function, etc. These are not satisfying Dirichlet condition. Okay. Let's see. Now let's start directly with one problem. Say xt equal to 1. Now if we plot it, so if we plot it, it will be something like, now if we take mod of xt and integrate it from minus infinity to plus infinity, it will be what? It is actually 1 dt, we are integrating it from minus infinity to plus infinity. After integration, it will be what? It is the area under the curve coming here, and that will tend to be infinity. Okay. So this is not satisfying this signal. Does not satisfy the condition of absolute integrability. Does not satisfy the condition of absolute integrability. Clear? Still, how we can find out how we can apply Fourier transform there? Okay. So here, to tackle the problem, we introduce a convergence factor. We introduce a convergence factor, okay, e to the limit e to the power minus sigma mod t, sigma tends to 0, which is equal to 1. Okay. So it is that convergence factor, we introduce it. Here, obviously, we know e to the power minus sigma mod t is e to the power sigma t, mod t equal to t. Okay. Mod t equal to minus t when t is negative, and mod t equal to t when t is positive. Okay. So this thing is absolutely integrable. because if we plot it, it will be going there, e to the power minus sigma mod t. Okay, so it is absolutely integrable. This is the convergence factor. It is convergent. So area under the curve is finite, and therefore area under the mod of this curve, mod is not important here because it's already real and positive. So ultimately it comes down to the area under the curve directly, which is finite. So area is finite actually. Clear? Now if we find out the Fourier transform x j omega, which is what? Fourier transform of x t or Fourier transform of 1. Okay, what we do here, we introduce actually the concept of 1 is not this x t, it is not absolutely integrable. So what we do, we introduce that convergence factor. So we write it is 1 into that convergence factor is multiplied because its final value is 1. So it is 1 into the original function x t into that one. So limit sigma tends to, so I write it here, so that 1 into limit e to the power minus sigma mod t, that one we can write. Its final value is 1, so original thing remains same. Okay, or we can take limit outside, so it will be Fourier transform of e to the power minus sigma mod t. Now it's already, this is a known result, so we can write 2 sigma by sigma square plus omega square. Okay, so it's already known, so I'm not calculating it. I'm not finding out the Fourier transform directly. Okay, now once we know this result, now, so what will be the result? I write it in the next page, page number 2. Now, when omega not equal to 0, Fourier transform 1 will be what? When omega is not equal to 0, so in the denominator it is non-zero. But when sigma tends to 0, finally it will be 0 by non-zero, so result will be 0. And when omega equal to 0, what happens? Okay, when omega equal to 0, so omega is 0 and sigma tends to 0, so it will take 0 by 0 form. So it will take 0 by 0 form. So you can write it, it takes 0 by 0 form. Okay, so we can apply L'Hospital's rule. We get Fourier transform 1 is limit sigma tends to 0. So ultimately we are taking derivative with respect to sigma. Okay. So we are writing it derivative. So derivative with respect to sigma, that is the numerator divided by derivative with respect to sigma for the denominator also. So derivative, this one. So this is, we can write limit sigma tends to 0. So it will be 2. And here it will be 2 sigma. Now as, so it will be what? When sigma tends to 0, that will tend to be 1 by 0 or infinity. So hence we can write what? Fourier transform 1 is 0 when omega not equal to 0 and tends to infinity when omega equal to 0. So if we plot xj omega or Fourier transform 1 as a function of frequency, what we'll get? It will tend to be infinity at omega equal to 0. And for all other omega, it will be 0. So therefore, in other words, we can write xj omega or Fourier transform 1, that must be equal to some k into delta omega, where k is the strength of the impulse function. For impulse function, we know it is zero everywhere except at omega equal to zero, that variable equal to zero, argument equal to zero, where it will tend to be infinity. So k is the strength. So our task is to find out the value of k. So our task is to find the value of k. So how to find out? Now, let's see, we integrate it, integration xj omega d omega, minus infinity to plus infinity. Why we are integrating? Because if we integrate, integration of delta omega with respect to omega is 1. So that's why we can, in that method, we can find out the value of k. Now, what is our xj omega? So that integration xj omega, we put the value of xj omega. This is already known, our x omega is this particular value. Okay, so this is our particular value, this one. We put it here, x omega. So limit sigma tends to 0 to sigma by sigma square plus omega square d omega. Or here we can write it is integration. In place of x omega, we can write that k into delta omega. So limit sigma tends to 0, it's taken outside. Okay. So it's 2 sigma by sigma square plus omega square d omega. So now I write it in the next page. Page number 3. So it will be k into d omega is there. So it is k into integration delta omega d omega minus infinity to plus infinity equal to limit sigma tends to 0. Okay. So I write it 2 sigma. Actually, just I copied from the previous page. Okay. Or it is k into its integration is 1 equal to. Now 2 sigma into, it is what? It's a standard integral, 2 sigma can be taken outside. So it will be 1 by sigma tan inverse omega by sigma minus infinity to plus infinity. Or it is k equal to limit sigma tends to 0 to tan inverse omega by sigma, that one. Now note that it is 2 into, now tan inverse infinity means pi by 2, 90 degree. And tan inverse minus infinity is minus 90 degree. So minus pi by 2, that one. So ultimately it is what? It is 2 into pi or 2 pi. So our xj omega, which is the Fourier transform of 1, is 2 pi, k is 2 pi delta omega. That is our result. So note that conceptually it is not easy to grasp it. By duality theorem, by applying duality theorem, we got the result earlier. But when we try to use the first principle of Fourier transform or the basic definition of Fourier transform, conceptually it is not simple at all because this signal does not satisfy Dirichlet condition. So what we do? We attach one convergence factor with the original signal xt. So once a convergence factor is attached with the original signal, this signal becomes convergent. So it becomes convergent. So actually what happens? So if we take different thing, values this one, that one, so for different values of omega, so as you see sigma decreasing. So when sigma is decreasing, it will approach towards, it is approaching towards unity value. Okay, it is approaching towards infinity. So it is xt into limit sigma tends to 0 to the power minus sigma mod t. So when we attach the convergence factor and we don't put the value of sigma in the beginning, we keep it as a limit outside. So when we don't put the value of sigma in the beginning, The Fourier transform operator does not know the value of sigma. So as the Fourier transform operator does not know the value of sigma, okay, it will think that this function is absolutely integrable, means it satisfies Dirichlet condition, then it gives us some result. After we get the result, at the final stage, we put the value of sigma there. So we are not supplying the value of sigma in the very beginning, so that the Fourier transform operator gets to know that this signal is absolutely integrable. It gives us some result, therefore. And once we get the result, now finally we put sigma equal to zero. So that's how the theory of Dirichlet condition is remaining intact, no problem at all at this. At the same time, the theory of Fourier transform is also fine, no problem here. Okay. So that's how, just by attaching convergence factor, we can tackle this type of problem. Now another problem. Okay. Consider that we want to find out signum function, say SGNT. SGNT equal to, we want to find out the Fourier transform SGNT. So what is that? Okay, we write let XT equal to SGNT, signum function. Okay, it is what? This is actually 1 when t is positive. It is 0 when t is 0. And minus 1 when t is negative. This one. So if we put, okay, XT, okay, or SGNT. Yes, XT or SGNT. Then it will be something like this one. It will be 1 and minus 1. Now note that if we take mod of xt dt minus infinity plus infinity, mod means it is always 1 for all t, negative or positive. So it will tend to be infinity. So xt is not absolutely integrable. So what we'll do, again, we'll attach the convergence factor. Therefore, we are attaching the convergence factor. So xt equal to limit, okay? Sigma, we write SGNT limit sigma tends to 0 to the power minus sigma mod t. Its final value is 1, okay? So the convergence factor, its final value is 1. So we are attaching this convergence factor. Okay, same convergence factor here. So let's do it. Then what is our xt omega? Page number 4. So xt omega, or the Fourier transform xt, is SGNT limit sigma tends to 0 to the power minus sigma mod t. This. So now we want to take Fourier transform. Okay. So minus infinity to plus infinity SGNT into limit sigma tends to 0 e to the power minus sigma mod t e to the power minus g omega t dt. So that is the definition of, this is our function, and that is the definition of Fourier transform. Now, then what we do is segregate into two parts. First, we take limit outside, okay? And then we are writing it's minus infinity to 0 and 0 to infinity. In the interval minus infinity to 0, our t is entirely negative. So SGNT will be what? Minus 1. You see, when t is negative, SGNT is minus 1. So we write it minus 1, okay? And e to the power minus, and what is mod t? Mod t equal to minus t for negative t. So it will be e to the power sigma t, e to the power minus g omega t dt. Clear? And when t is positive in that range, 0 to infinity, then sgnt is plus 1. And this e to the power, and mod t equal to t, so e to the power minus sigma t, e to the power minus j omega t as usual, t dt. So we can write limit sigma tends to 0, minus infinity to 0, there is a minus sign, e to the power sigma minus j omega t dt plus 0 to infinity to the power minus sigma plus j omega t dt. That. So now we can integrate it readily. Minus, its integration is e to the power sigma minus j omega t by sigma minus j omega, and integration limit is minus infinity to 0. For the next part, it will be just e to the power that minus sigma plus j omega t. So minus sigma plus j omega here 0 to infinity, this one. So we put t equal to 0. So it's 1, e to the power 0, 1 minus e to the power minus infinity. Now e to the power minus infinity is 0. Plus, this next is minus sigma plus j omega. Here e to the power minus infinity is 0. And put t equal to 0, e to the power 0, 1. So what happens? Limit sigma tends to 0, it is, we can write it minus 1 by sigma minus j omega plus 1 by sigma plus j omega. Now put sigma equal to 0. So it will be what? 2 by j omega. So this is the Fourier transform of signum function. So you see, originally our xt is not absolutely integrable, the signum function. So we attach a convergence factor. So once we attach a convergence factor, what will be the look of xt? It will be something like this one. And so as sigma tends to 0, so sigma decreasing. So when sigma tends to 0, it will approach towards the actual sigma function. But when sigma is increasing, what will happen? It will be more and more decaying in nature. It will be more and more decaying in nature when sigma is increasing. A decaying function means it is convergent, and therefore it will be absolutely integrable. So again, what we do? We don't put the value of sigma in the beginning. First, we take it aside. So the Fourier transform operator does not know the value of sigma. So it thinks that it is a decaying function, it is a convergent function, means it is satisfying the condition of absolute integrability. So the Fourier transform operator returns some value. Once we get the value, we put sigma equal to 0 at the end. Once we get the value, we put sigma equal to 0 at the end, and then our result is obtained. So we are not supplying the value of sigma in the convergence factor, okay? So that the Fourier transform operator now thinks that the original signal is absolutely integrable. It is decaying means, it is convergent means, it is absolutely integrable. And therefore, it gives us some result. So that is the method by which we can handle a wide variety of signals, okay? Just by attaching a proper convergence factor. By attaching a proper convergence factor. Clear? Now, obviously, if we plot mod of x omega is what? 2 by mod omega. So it is that one. Know that our original signal is an odd function. See that our original signal is an odd function. This one. Therefore, its Fourier transform is imaginary and even. Sorry, imaginary and odd. So one j is there. And what is the phase of this? Phi omega. Now phi omega is, it is 1 by j means minus 90 degree. When omega is positive. It is when omega is, and when omega is negative, 1 by j minus 90 into another negative omega. So it will be plus 90. So it is this one, minus 90 and plus 90. So this is always even. The magnitude spectrum, the phase spectrum is always odd. Clear? Okay. Now, our last problem. Page number 5. Problem 3. Find the Fourier transform of UT. So if you plot UT, integration of mod UT dt, it is what? It is actually from 0 to infinity, it is 1, and that tends to infinity. So UT is not absolutely integrable. Okay. So what we do, what we can attach? We can write our UT. So we can take some XT equal to UT into, now we are attaching this convergence factor, that one. So our XJ omega, so our finally XT equal to UT, because this value is 1 finally. So XJ omega or UJ omega is what? So it is the Fourier transform of XT to the power minus j omega to dt. Or we can write UT limit sigma tends to 0, just substitute it. Or we can take limit outside. And UT means it is 0 in the negative side of t. So it will be 0 to infinity, its value is 1. So it is e to the power, and t is positive. So it will be e to the power minus sigma t, e to the power minus j omega t dt. Since UT equal to 0 for negative t and 1 for positive t. So now we can just make some manipulation. So after integration, what we get? After integration, we get limit sigma tends to 0. So I'm not integrating it. It will be just, I give you the result. Fill up the steps. I write. Or we can write limit sigma tends to 0. Now sigma minus chi omega we can write. Just by multiplying it with complex conjugate. Okay, so what we do, we just write it in the next page. We are segregating it in two parts. Page number 6. So this is equal to limit sigma tends to 0. Sigma by sigma square plus omega square minus j omega by sigma square plus omega square. Means if you see this one, you will get sigma by sigma square plus omega square minus j omega by sigma square plus omega square. Just separating it into two parts. Okay. Now this thing we can write it equal to say some real part, a function of frequency, minus j imaginary part, a function of frequency, where the real part of this thing is limit sigma tends to zero, sigma by sigma square plus omega square, and imaginary part is it is omega by sigma square plus omega square. Now so our now first we start with imaginary part. Note that it's sigma. Now when we put sigma equal to zero, what will get? When sigma equal to zero, it will be 1 by omega for all values of omega. That is our imaginary part. And what is the real part? The thing is that when omega not equal to zero, say when omega not equal to zero, then it will be zero by non-zero. So it is zero for omega not equal to zero. And for omega equal to zero, what happens? Okay. It takes UR by omega, it takes. So when sigma is zero and omega is zero, it will be taking zero by zero form. And L'Hospital's rule. Is applied. Therefore, our UR omega equal to limit sigma tends to zero. Now we take the derivative. Or its derivative is 1 and its derivative is 2 sigma. So it tends to infinity. Tends to infinity. Hence, UR omega is an impulse. Is an impulse function. Because for all omega not equal to zero, UR omega is zero. But for omega equal to zero, it is going towards infinity. Okay, UR omega is an inverse function. So UR omega, so we write it as some k into delta omega. So k need to be found. This value needs to be found. Then what? How to find out this? So just integrate it. Now UR omega is this particular thing. We substitute the value of UR omega here. Limit sigma tends to zero, sigma by sigma square plus omega, this one. Or we can write it is k into delta omega d omega. Same method that we have adapted earlier. Right. Or k into delta omega d omega. Now sigma can be taken outside and it is a standard integral. 1 by sigma tan inverse omega by sigma. Minus infinity to plus infinity. So this is K into 1 equal to, now sigma is cancelled here and it is so now you see, when omega tends to infinity, it will be tan inverse infinity means pi by 2. And when omega tends to minus infinity, it is minus pi by 2. So it's simply pi. Okay, in the previous thing, you see, you got just one factor, 2 was there, only differences in the previous problem. 2 was there, but no 2 here. It is simply pi. So k equal to pi. K equal to pi. So our so u I omega. See. So ultimately we know now u I omega is 1 by omega. And u r omega is k delta omega, where k equal to pi. And u omega, that is uj omega, just we started with uj omega, which is equal to ur omega minus j ui omega. So we can write, therefore uj omega equal to ur omega minus j u I omega, where ur omega equal to pi delta omega and ui omega is 1 y omega. Therefore, uj omega is pi delta omega minus j, okay, 1 y omega. Okay. So pi delta omega now plus 1 by j omega we can write, because minus sign means j square into j cube, so it is j cube by j to the power 4, so 1 by j, so we can write it clear. So minus j means j square into j, or j cube, or j cube by j to the power 4, since j to the power 4 equal to 1, so it is 1 by j. So you already know, still I am writing it. So Fourier transform of UT is equal to pi delta omega plus 1 by j omega. Now alternatively, the same result can be found in another way. Okay. Now first we plot 1 versus t. So if we plot, what it will be? The same result can be found in another way. And now we plot SG and T. Now we are adding. So if we add 1 plus SG and T, then what we get? It is 1 plus 1, 2. And it is 1 minus 1, 0. So when we add these two, these plus that, so the result is this. So we can write 1 plus SGNT equal to 2 into UT, or UT equal to half of 1 plus SGNT. So UJ omega equal to what? Half into Fourier transform 1 is 2 pi delta omega. And SGNT is Fourier transform is 2 by j omega. So pi delta omega plus 1 by j omega. That is our result. That way also we can get it in another way. a simpler way. But if we are asked to find out uj omega, Fourier transform ut, from the basic definition of Fourier transform, then we have to adapt first method, not this method. We have to adapt first method, not this second method. Clear? Now, now we want to know that one more thing, that so in general, that therefore as a whole, if xt does not satisfy the condition of absolute integrability, okay, then we can attach a convergence factor in general as limit sigma tends to zero e to the power minus sigma t, which is equal to 1. I am not writing mod t, because if there is a mod t, t can be made positive or negative, but when we may write mod t, okay, when we write mod t, then sigma, the value, the range of sigma will be simply restricted. It will be always positive. But if t can take any value, then depending on the value of t, our sigma can be anything depending on our requirement. Okay, so in general, it is our convergence factor. So sigma can take appropriate value. So that's why then we are not writing sigma greater than zero here. So thus, what we can write, Fourier transform of xt or simply xj omega, that can be written as Fourier transform of, okay, limit e to the power minus sigma t, sigma tends to zero. It is limit sigma tends to zero. So it is xt to the power minus sigma t. Sorry, a Fourier transform is there. Or we can write its Fourier transform is what? So it is a pagal ketuna. So it is. So we can write it that way. Clear? Or we can write it as xt to the power minus sigma plus j omega, we can write it s, where s equal to sigma plus j omega. Clear? Now, after integrating it with respect to t and substituting the limits, t will not exist anymore. It will be a function of s only. So we can write limit sigma tends to zero, it is xs, a function of s, where xs equal to xt e to the power minus st dt. Okay. This is a, so a time domain function is converted into a s domain function. Okay. It is called Laplace transform of xt. So it is t to, so you can write it is t to s conversion. it is not conversion from t to omega, it's t to s. So it's the Laplace transform. So Fourier transform is nothing but the, actually what happens here, Fourier transform is nothing but the Laplace transform where s equal to j omega, because sigma is zero. S equal to j omega, sigma equal to zero. Okay. So that is this thing actually. So from, okay, when a signal does not satisfy the condition of absolute integrability, we attach a convergence factor. Effectively, we are using then Laplace transform. So Laplace transform is more general in nature. So when xt does not satisfy Dirichlet condition, okay, so when xt does not satisfy the condition of absolute integrability, the condition of absolute integrability, okay, we can use Laplace transform. Okay, to find xs from xt and put s equal to j omega, that is sigma equal to zero. Okay, although this substitution is mostly valid. Substitution is mostly valid with some exception as well. Example, say ut, its Laplace transform is what? 1 by s. But ut, its Fourier transform is what? It is pi delta omega plus, okay? So I already wrote it that it is pi delta omega plus 1 by j omega. Here, s equal to j omega is not applicable. Why it's not applicable sometimes? Because at t equal to zero, discontinuity in the signal. At t equal to zero plus, it is one. At t zero minus, it's zero. There is a discontinuity. So when there is a discontinuity, this function is not integrable also. At that point, in that case, okay, the substitution of s equal to j omega will not be valid. So although that substitution is mostly valid for converting Laplace transform to Fourier transform, it is not always valid. Okay, it is not always valid when there is a discontinuity or lack of integrability of the original function. Clear? So that, but when it is applicable, Laplace transform will be more general in nature. When it is applicable, Laplace transform is more general and versatile in nature than Fourier transform. Why? Because in Laplace transform, the sigma is also used. The convergence factor, e to the power sigma, that is the decay factor. The decaying of the function is used. It's more general in nature. But in Fourier transform, that sigma is zero. That creates a problem, okay, when the function is not already convergent. In Laplace transform, we add a further convergence factor, e to the power minus sigma. But in Fourier transform, no convergence factor is originally used. So that's why Laplace transform is more general than Fourier transform. And or in other words, Fourier transform is a special case of Laplace transform. Fourier transform is a special case of Laplace transform. That's why in your circuit theory class or in control system class, you use always Laplace transform, not Fourier transform. Because even when the function is originally not integrable at some point or is having some discontinuity, the Laplace transform will just give simple result. But the Fourier transform is not readily found, is not readily found. Okay, we need to attach some convergence factor to get our job done. To get the result, operator is easy to work with. Laplace transform operator is easy to work with. That's why we use Laplace transform operator in circuit theory class or in control system and in many, many other applications. Because inherently it uses sigma, it means it uses the convergence factor. That's my point. So this AS is actually called complex frequency. Clear? So it means that, so what we can say that when xg omega does not exist, okay, xs may exist. Okay. So because Fourier Laplace transform is more general in nature, when xg omega does not exist, why it does not exist? Because it is not satisfying Dirichlet condition. It is not satisfying Dirichlet condition. Then also xs may exist. Yeah. Now, what is our xs? It is the Laplace transform of xt. Or we can write it, it is integration xt e to the power minus st dt, minus infinity to plus infinity in general. Okay. Or we can write e to the power minus sigma plus j omega t dt. Or it is xt e to the power minus sigma t and e to the power minus j omega t dt. This is what? It is something like the Fourier transform of that function. So you can say it is the Fourier transform of xt e to the power minus sigma t. Clear? So xs is nothing but the Fourier transform of that particular thing. Clear? So I write it here, it is xs, it is relation one I am writing. I will refer it later. Now, next page, page number what? I just forgot to give page number 7 it was. Then it is 8. Now it is 9. Now 10. So just I am rewriting the whole thing in the next page. X is equal to Fourier transform of that. So we write X is equal to Fourier transform of xt e to the power minus sigma t. Rewriting previous line. আমি তোমাদের এইভাবে লিখছি একটাই কারণে, কারণ অনেকেরই বইটই পাওয়ার অসুবিধা কনসাল্ট করার, যে যার বাড়িতে বসে আছো, যাতে এই মেটেরিয়ালটাই একটা ইটসেলফ মোটামুটি একটা কম্প্রিহেন্সিভ কিছু একটা দাঁড়ায়, সেই জন্য আমি যতটা সম্ভব তোমাদের লেখার চেষ্টা করছি। ক্লাসে বোর্ড ওয়ার্ক করলে অনেক কিছু মুখে বলি, বোর্ডে লিখি না আর কি, সেটা আমি এখানে চেষ্টা করছি ওরকম ভাবে না করার আর কি। সো এক্সেস, সো নাও, অর উই ক্যান রাইট রাদার ইন আ রিভার্স ওয়ে, or xt into e to the power minus sigma t, it is the inverse Fourier transform of xs. So what is the inverse Fourier transform of xs? It is 1 by 2 pi integration xs e to the power j omega t d omega. That is the formula for inverse Fourier transform. We know that the original function into e to the power j omega t d omega, that one. That is the inverse Fourier transform. Okay. Now we write our xt equal to, we just put in the, just transpose these in the right side. So it is xs e to the power, that sigma is coming to the right. That one. Or st d omega. Now we note that s equal to sigma plus j omega. So when omega tends to infinity, s will be sigma plus j infinity. So when omega tends to infinity plus infinity, s will be sigma plus j infinity. Yeah. Sorry. Now ds is what? Ds equal to j d omega. Yes. So d omega equal to ds by j, I should write. Now when omega tends to plus infinity, s will tend to sigma plus j infinity. And when omega equal to minus infinity, s is sigma minus j infinity. So we can write 1 by 2 pi j. So xt equal to 1 by 2 pi j sigma minus j infinity to sigma plus, sorry, sigma plus j infinity xs e to the power st ds. So that is the formula for inverse Laplace transform. Inverse Laplace transform. So that is our journey from Fourier transform to Laplace transform. That is our journey from Fourier transform to Laplace transform. Clear? Yeah. Note that here, okay, write it in the next page. And we start with the relation one in the next page. Xs equal to this. Laplace transform of xt is Fourier transform of xt into e to the power minus sigma t. Okay. Page number 11. Referring to relation 1, what we get? Xs is the Fourier transform of xt e to the power minus sigma t. I told you that when Fourier transform does not exist, then also Laplace transform may exist. But what happens when, whether Laplace transform exists or not? Okay. Now when X's exist, okay, X's exists, X's exist, just 1 minute, hold. Second row at a short table. Now, X exists when Fourier transform of xt into to the power minus sigma t exists. Now Fourier transform exists. Fourier transform this thing exists when? So when Fourier transform this thing exists. Now when Fourier transform this thing exists, that is when xt into e to the power minus sigma t is absolutely integrable. When this is absolutely integrable, then only its Fourier transform exists and then only Laplace transform of xt exists. Now when it will be absolutely integrable, the range of sigma for which the range of sigma for which xt into e to the power minus six sigma t is absolutely integrable, that is Fourier transform of xt into the power minus sigma t exists, that is xs exists, is called the region of convergence, ROC. The range of sigma for which, I repeat, the range of sigma for which xt into to the power minus sigma t is absolutely integrable, that is Fourier transform of this thing exists, that is Laplace transform of xt exists, that range of sigma is called region of convergence. It means that when we are given any signal xt, whether we can find its Laplace transform or not, that depends on the range of sigma. This is a new thing that we did not bother about earlier. Okay. Therefore, Laplace transform of xt exists for a certain range of sigma called ROC, region of convergence. It's not that we'll be getting any xt and we can find out its Laplace transform. No, it's not possible. This is going against our previous knowledge. How? I'll give you problem. It will be clear then. It will be clear then. Let's see one. Just very simple problem. Find the Laplace transform of the following signals and their corresponding ROCs. A hoche e to the power minus at ut, B minus e to the power minus at ut. It's very simple problem. You can say, why at this stage we are asked to do such simple problem? But no, it's apparently simple. Conceptually, it's not simple. Let's see. Our xt equal to e to the power minus at ut. Okay. So xs is just this one. Or we can write xt equal to e to the power minus at ut. That one. Or or it is ut into e to the power minus s plus a t dt. Or we can write 0 to infinity e to the power minus s plus a t dt. Ut equal to 0 for negative t and 1 for positive t. Or I am integrating it because of some reason. It's very simple, still I am doing it. Or it is e to the power, now minus, put t equal to infinity, e to the power minus infinity is 0. Put t equal to 0, 1. Or 1 by s plus e. Now, so it's a known result, but see one thing. Who told us that when we put t equal to infinity, it will be e to the power minus infinity? Who told us? It is based on the assumption that our s plus a is positive. If s plus a is positive, then only e to the power minus into plus infinity, then e to the power minus infinity, and then only it will be 0. So that condition must be stated clearly. Otherwise, we cannot write a 0 here. If s plus a is negative, it will be minus into plus. So it will be our plus infinity. So this will be a 0. Sorry, this will be an infinity, not 0. So this is called our ROC. So what is our ROC? ROC region of convergence is S plus A must be 0, greater than 0, or sigma plus chi omega plus A must be greater than 0. Clear? Now from that, we can omit chi omega. We can write sigma plus A greater than 0. Why? How we can omit it? Let's see. E to the power minus s plus a into t. So it is e to the power minus sigma plus chi omega plus a t. E to the power minus sigma plus a into t. E to the power minus chi omega t. Now, this is equal to 0. This is equal to 0. Or we can write it what? It is e to the power minus sigma plus a t. Angle minus omega t. This e to the power minus j theta means what? Cos theta minus j sin theta. Its angle is theta. That is minus j omega t. Now this is equal to 0 when sigma plus a is positive. Because this omega term, it does not contribute to the magnitude. It contributes to the phase only, phase angle only. So the whole thing will be 0. This is equal to 0 when sigma plus a is greater than 0. So it is sufficient to write sigma plus a greater than 0 from this thing. Okay. So this is the logic that when sigma plus g omega plus a is 0, g omega being a power in the exponential part, it contributes to the phase term and does not come in the magnitude. So therefore, we can omit it. Only sigma plus a contributes to the magnitude. And when the magnitude is 0, it is sigma plus a. Okay. So when sigma plus a tends to 0, then for t tends to infinity, then it will be e to the power minus sigma plus a into t, it will tend to 0. So when t tends to infinity, then it will be e to the power minus into plus infinity, and then it will be 0. Whole thing will be 0. Or our sigma, we can write is what? Sorry. You are right.
Thank you.
So when sigma plus a greater than 0, then for t tends to infinity, e to the power minus into plus infinity, e to the power minus infinity, so it will be 0 then. So it is sufficient to write sigma plus a greater than 0 or sigma greater than minus. But sigma is what? Sigma is the, we know sigma is the real part of S, because s equal to sigma plus j omega. Okay, so we can write real part of S must be greater than minus E. So if in the S plane we write sigma, okay, which is the real part of S, and if we write omega, which is the imaginary part of S, okay, say our, now note that what is A? A is the location. So there is a pole, we know. Do you know the concept of pole? Tell me, you know the concept of pole or not? What is a pole? Pole is actually when we get something by zero form. When the functional value cannot be determined at the value of, for a particular value of S, it means there is a pole. So it means that at S equal to minus A, there is a pole of XS. You will learn lot more things on pole in the subject control system. Control system e tumra eta aro onek beshi kore pole er byapar porbe. Eituku amra bolbo ekhane shudhumatro je when we get something by zero, the value becomes indeterminate, then the for the value of S for which we are getting something by zero means there is a singularity of the function, then that value of S is the location of the pole. So our real part of S must be right to the location of the pole. Now minus A is what? It's A is real. So this is a minus A. It is the location of the pole. Location of the pole of XS. So our sigma must be right to this. So our sigma must be right to this. It must be greater than, not greater than equal to. So this is our ROC. So it is the region of convergence, the range of sigma. So this is the range of sigma equal to real part of S. So if our sigma is right to the pole, if sigma is right to the pole, then its Laplace transform exists. We can write a zero here. E to the power minus infinity will be zero. And we can get a finite, otherwise the value of XS will be infinitely large. Some infinity will come here. Okay, so that is the region of convergence for which XS exists. This is the region of convergence for which XS exists. So when our sigma is right to the pole location, then only its Laplace transform exists. Otherwise, it does not exist. Otherwise, it does not exist. Actually, it is a causal signal. If we plot, okay, it is a causal signal. For a causal signal, always we can say that our ROC must be right to the pole location. So our conclusion is what I write in page number 13. Okay. So note, for a causal signal, its ROC must be right to its pole location. Pole location, obviously in the S plane. So that is the important thing. Now we are almost at the end. Now our next problem, so B. So our xt equal to minus e to the power. Minus a t u minus t. Sorry, it's not u t. It is u minus t. There is a mistake. U minus t. Minus sign must be there. Now we know what? Our ut is, this is our ut. And u minus t is just the mirror image, time reversal. So u minus t equal to 1 when minus t is greater than equal to 0 or t is less than 0. And is 0 when minus t is less than 0 or t is greater than 0. So this is our u minus t. So if we plot xt it will be what? Our T is negative. Okay. So as T is negative, now our A can be anything we can write depending on the value of A. A may be positive, negative, whatever. We will investigate it later. Okay, so let's see. Now we want to find out. So it's an anticausal signal. Anticausal. It's negative side and it's causal. So now what is our excess? Or minus e to the power minus a t u minus t e to the power minus t dt. Now u minus t, it is 1 for t less than equal to 0. So it will be from minus infinity to 0 for negative t, u is 1. Now, if we integrate it, integration is very simple. So minus infinity to 0. So we can write it as put t equal to 0, 1, e to the power 0, 1, minus t equal to minus infinity. So it will be, so it is e to the power minus infinity 0. So finally it will be what? 1 by s plus e. Who told us that when t is minus infinity, it will be e to the power minus infinity? It means you have assumed something. What is? The assumption is s plus a must be negative. If s plus a is negative, then e to the power minus into another minus into a third minus infinity. So finally, it will be e to the power minus infinity or zero. So again, following the same logic, we can get that sigma plus a less than zero or sigma less than a or real part of s must be less than a. Sorry, minus a. So, but a is what? It is the pole location. Pole at s equal to minus a. A pole is at s equal to minus a. Actually, here the convention is at pole location always we put across. So, it is the pole location. There is a singularity of the function. So, if we plot it again, what we get? Page number 14. So it is, there is a pole location and minus a, and our sigma should be what? A real part of s, it will be less than minus a, less than pole location. Sorry, it's a s plane. So it's sigma, real part of s, it's omega, imaginary part of s. Here also, this is our S plane, sigma and j omega. Here also, I write it S plane. So, our sigma must be left to minus a. It should be less than minus. So, if we draw it a line, it will be left to this. That is our ROC, the range of sigma. So, excess exists here. Here. This is the ROC. So when sigma is less than minus a, then only its Laplace transform exists. Otherwise, it will get e to the power plus infinity, not zero. So the excess will be infinitely large. Excess will be infinitely large. Clear? So I want to conclude today with our last problem. Find the Laplace transform of xt where xt equal to that one. Okay, before that I want to put a note. Just in the previous case also I put, for a causal signal its ROC must be right to its pole location. For an anti-causal signal ROC must be left to its pole location, left to its pole locations. Note that this is the causal signal. Now we want to find out its Laplace transform. Now xt equal to e to the power minus a t ut plus e to the power minus b u minus t. Now one more thing you see, you note that for a causal signal, the sign does not change. It is plus e to the power minus a t ut. Its result is 1 by s plus. But for anti-causal signal, there is a minus sign before. And finally, we get 1 by s plus. So for an anti-causal signal, not only the ROC is different, ROC is left to the pole. In the result, sign also changes. Sign also changes. There is a change in sign. We started with a minus sign, that's why it is plus. So when we take Laplace transform, there is a change in sign for anti-causal signal. So if we take x as, now this is causal and that is anti-causal. So there is no change in sign when we put 1 by s plus a, but for anti-causal signal, there will be a change in sign. It will be s plus b. That will be s plus b. But this is the result that may not exist always. It will exist, we'll get that result only when we will have some ROC. So what is the ROC for causal signal? We write, okay, our ROC is, we write it ROC 1.
E to the power minus b.
There will be a minus sign because for anti-causal signal, I told you just now, we started with a negative, minus.
So I'm talking about the function.
Which function?
The function that you're given. E to the power minus b u minus t.
It is e to the power, yes, e to the power minus bt, bt. You are right. Thank you. So it is ROC 1 and that we assume it is ROC 2. Now what will be the ROC 1? Laplace transform of this part will exist only when its ROC is satisfied. That is, it is a causal signal. So ROC will be right to the pole rather than minus. Its pole location, it will be right to the pole. Okay. So the causal part will exist. So causal part exists under this condition. For ROC2, anti-causal part will exist when sigma is less than minus b. So it will be left to the pole location. So anti-causal part exists. Now our excess will exist when both the thing will exist, causal and anti-causal. So x says its ROC is, we assume ROC, the overall ROC. The overall ROC will be the intersection of ROC 1 and ROC 2 when both the ROCs are satisfied. This means when our sigma is greater than minus A and less than minus B. When it is greater than minus A and less than minus B, then only our excess will exist. Means when both the ROCs are satisfied. Otherwise, what will happen? Either these will exist or that will exist, or none of them will exist. If so, when three of them, so when both of them exist simultaneously, then only we can see as excess exist. The overall Laplace transform is possible. So it's not that we are given a function and blindly we'll say that yes, Laplace transform exists. So what happens actually? Say there are two poles here, one at minus A and another is at minus B. So our ROC will be in between these two. That is the ROC. ROC. So here, what happens actually? Our mod A actually we have assumed is greater than mod B. So if mod A is greater than mod B, then only it is possible. So excess exists. For this range of sigma. Now, what happens when mod A is less than mod B? Okay. So I write it in the next, draw it in the next page. Page number 15, our last page today. Minus B minus A. So we can write our mod A is less than mod B. So it means that our sigma should be right to minus A to satisfy the causal part, and sigma should be left to minus B to satisfy the anti-causal part will exist. So if sigma is right to minus A, it cannot be left to minus B. So no possible ROC. No possible ROC. So excess does not exist. So if we are given, therefore, if xt equal to e to the power minus 3t ut, plus e to the power minus 5t u minus t, then a equal to 3 and b equal to 5. Say a equal to e to the power, you compare it, e to the power minus a t, e to the power minus bt u minus t. A equal to 3 and b equal to 5. Okay. So mod a, so obviously 3 less than 5. So then, we can straight away say that excess does not exist. It's Laplace transform. So if you write that this Laplace transform is 1 by s plus 3 minus 1 by s plus 5, it will be a wrong answer. No, it tends to be infinity. And if xt equal to e to the power minus 5t ut plus e to the power minus 3t u minus t, so you see our mod A is greater than mod B in the previous case and its excess exists. Now you can write 1 by s plus 5 minus 1 by s plus 3 will be the valid result for Laplace transform. Get my point? So that's with this I want to end today. But before that, one more thing. আচ্ছা আর একটা ক্লাস কি নেওয়া সম্ভব যদি হলো হলো নালে এই অবধি আসলে আর কিছুই না কোশ্চেন আসা না আসাটা ইম্পর্টেন্ট না ইম্পর্টেন্ট হচ্ছে তোমাদের জানার দরকার আর একটা যদি হয় তোমরা আমাকে জানিও কথা বলে কবে হবে হ্যাঁ, এমন হতেই পারে যে সেই ক্লাসটা আমি ক্লাস টেস্টের মধ্যে রাখলাম না, সেটাও হতে পারে। সেটা দ্যাট ডাজেন্ট ম্যাটার, সেটা ইম্পর্টেন্ট নয়। তাহলে আমি আর একটা ক্লাস নেব, সেটা তোমরা কথা বলে আমাকে অহন জানিয়ে দিও হোয়াটসঅ্যাপ করে আর কি, কবে হতে পারে আর কি।